There's the television. It's a monitor hooked up to the satellite box. An iPad that we will need later. A simple keyboard connecting to the setup box, which makes it easier to type. So let's first start the application. At the moment we are using the browser mode, which is actually the same as the HPTV mode. And so let's start up the application. So let me restart, is probably a better word. So first thing that we should see is the application running, and we indeed see a video file playing out. You can hear the audio. I will mute it a little bit more so that you can hear me clearly. But you can see it's now playing a video. You can already see that there's an overlay, which you'll find in the example to test that element. Now the first thing that we are of course showing in this example is that you can play video on HPTV with the correct tag being sent out. The second thing you already see is an overlay, which is nice. The third thing, which is really a practical one, is to show that the remote is working. So let me pause it and play it. Believe it or not, it has a very small play and pause button, but you can see that indeed it's pausing and it's playing again. So that's cool, it kind of works. Now, as explained before, it's a multi-screen toolkit. So now basically there are three devices already kind of hooked up. The remote, an extension, the HPTV box, the server, and we are now going to add an iPad just to see if the remote application works. So let me move the keyboard away and move the iPad into view. So I start up the application, and it's quite small, but I will turn it to the camera. You can already see that there's now sort of a progress bar running. It's like I said, we kept it extremely basic so that the example stays really easy to follow. But you can probably see that I can now also pause it. And you see that it's paused. It's also says on the screen paused, which you will find the example. And I can play it. And you'll see that now it continues to play and it says, well, play hit at 94,000 milliseconds. And you can see here also the time sort of continuing. Of course, if I pause it over here, it should act the same. You can see, and I can continue playing it here. So this is already kind of the basic interaction between these two three devices, and that you should be able to get it running once you have the application. But let's make it a little bit more fun. So we not just installed the remote application, but we can also want to be able to test some of the, let's say, more advanced features, even if this is a simple example. So let's see what happens if I start hitting the famous colored buttons. So let me first hit, so they're quite small. Sorry about that, it's not my mistake. But you can see that they're over here. And let me first hit the red button and see what happens. So, what happened? I hit the red button and the red thingy appears. And it's kind of nice. I can sort of move it around with using the arrow keys. And you can see in example how that sort of kind of moves, of how you can sort of implement that. Now, what would happen if I hit another color? Let's say the green one. Oh, a green object sort of pops up, and it's the same with the yellow one and the blue one. And what's nice about it, I can move them all about like this. And what I can use is also use the numbers to decide how big they are. So you can see that now becomes small if I hit one, and if I hit nine. And errors. It's kind of difficult to both aim it at the device and get it into view for you guys, but you can see that this is already kind of a simple application. So I hope that it's quite easy for you to follow in the code, and I will probably also make a special video explaining that a little bit. But let's see if we can have some more fun. So I was wondering, what will happen if you hit the zero key? Oh, you can also turn them off, by the way. So you can, for example, if you hit the OK button, one will go away, and the one that's active. The last one that is active is the one that you hit. So if you hit green, then it will start moving to green. If you hit red, then I will hit red. And you can turn it on off and you can turn it on again. You can see in the code that there's something called active, which we are keeping in the screen object so that I know which object I'm kind of playing with. But let's see what would happen if I make it so small. So one is already very small, as you can see. So let's make also the, let's make it move a little bit. I think probably we take the yellow one for this example. So I hit yellow, make it very small. There it is. Oops, what kind of happened here is interesting. I hit zero and it actually now is gone from my main screen and it started popping up on my second screen. So let's see what happens if I hit it again. If I hit it again, it moves back from to the main screen. And if I hit it again, it goes to the second screen again, which is kind of cool. Let's see if that also works for another object. Let's take the red one. So I take the red one. It's now clearly on the main screen, as you can see. And if I hit the zero, it jumps to the second screen. And I can still move it around, right? Which is kind of fun. As you can see. So what's actually happening is, I find quite interesting, it's using the remote control which is attached to one device, but since all devices, so the screen in this case, and that screen in this case, and the remote, are all in the same application. So it's actually quite simple to move these diffs, because all these objects are diffs in core, around. And it doesn't really matter what it is, you can also always sort of, keep interacting with it, which I think is kind of interesting and cool, and it's very easy to program. You will see that the example is about maybe I would say 200 lines of code, and actually I made it for readability. I copied quite a few lines of code, so all the objects, for example, you will find that there's called red, green, yellow and blue for obvious reasons, and you'll see that mostly I'm copying code from one example to another. And if you're really smart about how to program them, you can reduce it even further. Which in this case I didn't want to do, because I wanted to keep it readable. But you can see it's very easy using the toolkit to implement this stuff. Just to prove how flexible it is, let's also open up the computer and make this a little bit more complex and see what will happen. So let me first move all the objects back to the main screen. So I do that by hitting zero on the correct color, so I go to yellow, then hit the zero and it goes back to the main screen. So we still have this main screen, second screen working. Let me pause the video as proof. So there it is, it's now paused. And open this laptop, I didn't really prepare this part. So let me, as the end of this small demo, go to the same URL, which is not this one, but and I just wanted to show you that it works over any amount of windows. So now I have also one up and running here. And if I hit the play button, it should continue playing. Of course, a Mac doesn't have a touchscreen, so I should actually use the mouse, which luckily does work. So you can see that the video continues playing along, and I can also pause it here. So you can see that the numbers are all updated on this screen and this screen. And actually, if I move an object around again, so let me take the green one in this example. So aim it to the green, then hit zero. You see that it actually how multi-screen this is, because you now see that both on the iPad and on the desktop, you'll see the same object moving about in the same order. So we already have like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 devices working together, and it's actually, I find it, although we can make it even better, I think if you look at the code, it's quite simple. Please ask questions and read the rest of the wiki pages, but I hope this video kind of give you a good feeling of what you can do with this application and what you should get out of it, and which technical test cases are in there. So thank you for listening, and hope you enjoyed the little demo.